إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، إخواني أخواتي في الله وأحبائي في الله، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam and my dear loved ones in Islam, I greet you with the Islamic greeting of peace. May the peace and blessings and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon you and your families, inshallah. Although the virus, the coronavirus that we have been stricken with across the earth, across the lands, although it has caused us fear and worry and anxiety and has made us make unimaginable changes that we thought we would probably never have to make in our lifetime, and although it pains us to have these restrictions of being homebound and the likes, even more so with the blessed month and the holy month of the month of Ramadan about to enter upon us, and we ask Allah, Allahumma ballighna Ramadan, to be able to live even to see it, whether it be Friday or Saturday, and Allah knows best, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us remember to have good thoughts of our Lord, to have good thoughts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And remember the hadith that's authentic from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ قَوْمًا ابْتَلَاهُمْ, that indeed if Allah loves a people, he tests them and tries them. So we hope that this test, this trial that we're facing, is a way for us to come back to our Lord, come back to Allah, cleanse ourselves of sin, and be of those whom Allah is pleased with. So we need to have that good suspicion of our Lord. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this virus, it is from Junud Allah. It is the soldiers from the soldiers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look, normally we're afraid of things which are big and large and they're coming at us, things we can see. This virus is so microscopic, you need to magnify it many, 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 many times over just to see it. Yet we're so afraid of it and we're running away from it and going to great lengths to protect ourselves from it. قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. Without a doubt, this has happened all by Allah's decree, and Allah does what He chooses. It pains us to have to announce, though, that at this time, even with the blessed month of Ramadan coming, the time where the abwab al-jannah maftuha, the doors of Jannah are open, wa abwab jahannam mughliqa, and the doors of the hellfire are closed, wa sulsilat al-shayateen, and the shayateen are chained up. This is the time where we love to get back to the masjid, to recharge our batteries, to get closer to Allah, to His pleasure, to beg for forgiveness and mercy. And yet, going to the masjid being such a big part of it is something that we just cannot foresee being allowed, at least at the present time. The Islamic Center of Manteca, unfortunately, will be closed until further notice. We have to follow state and health guidelines, official guidelines for social gatherings and social distancing. And this is our duty as Muslims, to do so, to protect ourselves, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed, and as the ulama, the scholars, have been advising. This is what our deen calls us for, towards guidance. We must trust in Allah and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So many a times we see a thing and we don't know if it's good for us or not. We only look at it as bad or we look at it as good, and Allah knows. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَقْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, and perhaps you see a thing to be bad for you, but maybe it's good for you, and Allah knows and you don't know. And also the vice is true. So we ask Allah to make us have patience with this trial and to rely on Him and get closer to Him and come to Him at this time, making a lot of dua and seeking a lot of forgiveness. My brothers and sisters in Islam, the masajid have closed in the past due to epidemics. This is not the first time it's happened in the history of Islam. Imam al-Dhahabi, who was about 448 years after the Hijrah, he gave an example where the masajid were left closed without anyone praying in them. There was a drought great in Egypt and in Andalus, in the area of Spain, and no drought nor epidemic of its like was ever experienced in Qurtuba, to the extent that the masajid were left closed without anyone to pray in them, and it was known as the year of the great famine. This was a time where the masajid were closed due to that hardship and trial. The masajid have closed in our time. Society is in tumultuous times, in times of chaos and fear and worry. But look at the example of Masruq, rahimahullah, one of the tabi'een. And again, from what we have been learning, the companions, the sahaba, they're the best generation. Khayrun nas qarni, as the Prophet ﷺ said, the best of mankind is my generation. Thumma ladina yalunuhum. And the ones who followed the sahaba, they are called the tabi'een. Masruq was from them. And he, in his lifetime, he stayed at home and increased in worship and benefited from his time during one of the greatest trials. So being from the tabi'een, during an outbreak, he would say these are the days of preoccupation. People are preoccupied with the outbreak, disruption occurring everywhere to the norms of society. So I love to be alone for worship. And so he would withdraw for worship. And his wife would say, perhaps I would have sat behind him and cried from that which I see him doing to himself. He would pray till his feet would swell. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, one of the senior scholars of this ummah, he was asked about the directives given in the non-Muslim lands for the people not to gather in places of worship. And he was told, because early on, it was a recommendation per se, not a mandate. Mandates are clear. He said, even when there's a recommendation, they are recommendations because the government is not responsible for the places of worship, etc. He was asked, should they leave off praying in the masajid? Sheikh Saleh Al-Fawzan, Hafidhullah, he said, yes, that is for their own benefit, for the Muslims' own benefit. He then said, the questioner asked, well, the prayer within the congregational mosques has been prohibited. So should we pray in a recreational space? Like, should we gather in a park or somewhere outside of the masjid or whatever? He said, no, in doing so lies danger. This is what the sheikh responded. I said, well, what if they were to pray there anyway? What if people, they know all this, but they ignore that and they don't take heed? He said, the prayer is sound, but they bear a sin. Why they have opposed what the commands were, and this is for the safety of the Muslims. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we must always go back to our deen and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course fearing his punishment. But we go back and we have the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which many of the scholars have quoted with respect to this time. قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدِ أَوْ سَافَرَ كُتِبَ لَهُ مِثْلُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلْ مُقِيمًا صَحِيحًا. This hadith, which is in Sahih al-Bukhari, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, when a slave falls ill or travels, when something outside of your control prohibits you from doing good actions, fasting that you normally would do, going to the masjid to pray jama'ah that you normally would do, when a slave falls ill or travels or any of those likes, then he will get the reward similar to that he gets for good deeds practiced at home when he's in good health. So we have that to rely on, knowing that if the masjid was open, that we could go and pray there, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give us the same reward as if we're praying in the masjid, even if we're praying in our own homes. So the masajid, my dear brothers and sisters, they are closed and these are the restrictions. But all the rewards of going to the masjid remain based on your intention, what you would have normally be doing. And the call to the adhan at the house should be done. And we'll discuss this a little more, inshallah. And you should gather the family and pray together in the congregation, because congregational prayer is 25 to 27 times more rewarding. And at least the men in the house should pray together, but the whole family unit should pray together. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, although this restriction of not going to the masjid is there, it is still the blessed month of Ramadan. The doors of Jannah open. Allah is looking throughout the month to free necks from the hellfire. The doors of sadaqah, of charity, are open, and the Prophet ﷺ was the most generous in this time. Do not lose out on this blessed month and this blessed time. This is when Allah is going to see who really believes and who disbelieves, where Allah is going to really see who wants guidance and to come into the light, or who's fine staying in the dark and doesn't care to be guided. This is where Allah wants to see who wants to really be forgiven and earn His mercy, or who could care less. So do not be lazy. Do not kiss this month off because you cannot go to the masjid. Because really, when we were going, it was for Tarawih, which was, or Qiyam is the proper term. And this is from the Sunan, from the Sunnah practices of the Prophet ﷺ. The Fard prayers, where the masajid are very empty, is what's compulsory for the men of this ummah to do. And yani, we remind each other with this every month. Look how much we go during Ramadan. But then the five daily prayers are always scarce and not so many people. So we must be careful with what shaitan wants. Shaitan's licking his chops, thinking that, ha ha ha, the masajid are closed. Now's my time to make them lose out on their Ramadan. And we should not allow that to happen. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, a few little points and reminders and benefits. Number one, fasting is still prescribed. There has been some circulation. I've gotten some questions that some people are saying because of the coronavirus, you don't have to fast. Wal-a'yadu billah. There is no basis for this. The reasons for not fasting are clear. You're ill, severely ill, or on a journey, or you're a very old age, or a woman is pregnant and she fears for herself or her child, or she's nursing her child and fears for her child not having enough nourishment if she fasts, etc. The reasons are there. So we cannot be making these up. This is not a time to look for a way out of doing something that you should be doing to get yourself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So be mindful of this. Kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqoon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, what means fasting has been prescribed for you like it was prescribed for those before you, so you may achieve taqwa. This is the month where we have to get that taqwa back. And I remind myself first that consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keeping our duty to Allah, putting between ourselves and Allah's punishment a barrier because of our obedience to Him. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, fasting is still prescribed unless there is a very valid reason. Do not listen to just some random fatwas or rulings that say, oh, you don't have to fast due to COVID or whatever it may be. The things that break the fast for your ease, they're on the Islamic Center of Manteca website in the upper left-hand corner. Things that break the fast chart. You can click on it, you can print it. If you have any questions, you're always free to send a text or ask any questions, inshallah, and we'll do our best to answer them. My recommendation would be to avoid iftars. Not just, of course, in the masjid, we can't have them, but also with other family members. This virus is dangerous. And the more we circulate it, because we don't still, till this day, they're changing how long they think it lives in air, how far it can travel in air before it dies, or while it can still stay in a position where it can land on somebody and infect them. So we have to be cautious. We have to be wise. وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. One of the mashayikh, I called him, and this was his response for not going out to the masajid. Do not kill yourselves. Do not kill yourselves. And of course, لَا ضُرُرُ وَلَا دَرَارَ. Do not harm. Let there be no harm and no reciprocating harm. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, we should be mindful of this. Use this time to focus on the family. So little of times do we pray together as a family, make dhikr together as a family, especially in Ramadan, subhanAllah. Maybe Allah is doing this for a reason and He has the ultimate wisdom and we do not know. But subhanAllah, this is the time where you can focus on family, learn the deen of Allah, read the Quran, etc. With respect to these things, reading the Quran and what you to do with it, inshallah. This is the month of the Quran. This is the month in which the Quran was revealed. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. The month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed as a guidance for mankind and a clear criterion for that guidance and the criterion between right and wrong. A clear proof for that guidance and the criterion between right and wrong. if you don't know it or you can't read it, listen to it. Read the tafsir, read the explanation of it. Do something to learn the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Increase in dhikr, increase in dua. This is the time, especially during this waba wal bala, during these hardships and trials, that we should turn to Allah, remember Him, even with the basic ones, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, and also make dua to Him to protect us, to relieve us from this, to bless our families, etc. Regarding qiyam and tarawih prayers, the proper term is qiyam prayers. Again, we will not be holding them in the masjid until further notice. Allah knows best. It looks like it's going to be the whole month. But we will keep you posted, of course, if something changes and it's safe, then we will do so. These qiyam prayers, these night prayers, you should still do them in your home. The time for Isha comes in, you call the adhan. You call the aqama, you pray Salatul Isha and the two sunnah, and then you pray and make it easy on yourselves. Pray 8 rak'at. This was the sunnah, this is what the Prophet ﷺ did. And then he did the 3 for witr. Okay? For these qiyam, there's no virtual. And these are all questions that came, so I'm clarifying these things. There's no virtual prayer. We can't lead the prayer and on the phone or on Zoom, and people are following in a different location. This is not allowed for us to do. The ulama have ruled it out. The scholars have said this is not permissible. So with respect to this, still do it at home. The jama'ah is the best. If you do not know a lot of Quran, you can read the same surah over and over again. If you only know one surah, or you don't know, if you know how to read from the Quran, you can hold the mushaf, you can hold the Quran. And we have a proof for this, and we're going to mention it shortly. So do 8 rak'ahs, 2 by 2. Make it easy upon yourself. You don't have to read the whole Quran. You don't have to do a khatam. You don't have to finish the whole Quran. But if the head of the household can read in the prayers, inshallah, and lead the family in prayers, whether it's by memory or by repeating the same surah, even if it's Qul Huwa Allahu Ahad in every rak'ah, what can you do to make it more meaningful? Take more time in ruku' and glorify Allah. Take more time in sajda and sujood and praise Allah and make dua. There's a common thing we mention, because the sajda is one of the main pillars of the prayer, if not the main pillar of the prayer. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, he referred to the sajda, he said, مَا يَكُنُ الْعَبْدِ أَقْرَبُ إِلَى رَبِّهِ مِنْ وَنْ هُوَ سَاجِدْ فَأَكْثَرُ الدُّعَاءِ. The Prophet ﷺ, he said that a slave is closest to his Lord, closest to Allah when he is making sajda, so he should increase in dua. He should increase in dua during this time. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, the sajda that we see some brothers and sisters, well, for us the brothers, do so quickly, this is a great catastrophe. This is the thief, shaitan, stealing from the prayer by making you rush. Take time in your sajda. That's the best place to make dua. So even if you know Surah Al-Ikhlas only, and you read the Fatiha, and that's what you read, because you can't read from the Mus'haf, from the Quran, then read it. Take time in your ruku'. Take time in your sajda. Supplicate to Allah when your face and your nose and your forehead are on the ground, and supplicate to Allah at that time. Again, it's the time you are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where the abd is closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَأَكْثِرُ الدُّعَاءِ. So make the dua more while you're in sajda. Witr prayer should be 3 rak'ahs. You can pray them like we do in the masjid, 2 rak'ahs with taslim, and then 1 rak'ah to make it witr, which means odd. Or you can do it as 3 rak'ahs. But the correct way for that, if you do 3 connected ones, is to not sit for a tashahud until the last one. And all 3 are recited with some audible sound. They're not done silently, inshallah. Again, you can read from memory. You can read short surahs. You can repeat the surahs or ayat, if you only know the ayat. And you can hold the mushaf for the imam only. The people following the imam should not be holding the mushaf. Again, there is nothing wrong with this. A'asha radiallahu anha, she had a servant named Dhakwan, who used to lead her in prayers in Ramadan, reading from the Mus'haf. This hadith is in Bukhari. This hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari. So he used to lead her in prayers, holding the Mus'haf. And again, this hadith is acceptable. It's in Sahih al-Bukhari. Ibn Shihab, he said, the best of us used to read from the Mus'haf during Ramadan. And Nawawi, he said, if he reads from the Mus'haf, that does not invalidate the prayer, whether he has memorized it or not. Rather, he should do that if he has not memorized from it. And if he turns the pages or something while he's praying, this does not invalidate the prayer. So there's nothing wrong with the imam in nafil prayers. You just cannot do this in the fard. You cannot hold the mus'haf in fajr, dhuhr, asr, maghrib, or isha prayers. But in the nafil prayers, the sunan prayers, you can do so, and this is okay. Last thing, my brothers and sisters in Islam, just to be preemptive, zakat al-fitr and the fidya. Fidya will address first. The fidya is for the one who cannot fast, again, due to old age or due to being sick or ill and not recovering from that illness. Certain brothers or sisters who have an illness where the doctors, two or three of them, have said they cannot fast. You feed a poor person a half a sa' for each day you cannot fast. Just to be kind of generous at this time, we're going to still say this is $7 to $10 per day that person does not fast. Okay, if you have that fidya, you can contact me. We will set up a certain time or a special way to get that money out. You should pay it in the month of Ramadan, and that's what's best, the beginning, the middle, or towards the end, to feed for every day of Ramadan. Just count it as 30 days to be on the safe side. Allah knows how long the month will be. So that zakat, that fidya, afwan, is for ta'am al-miskeen, to feed the poor person for every day the person cannot fast. And there's different rulings. Again, if you need help deciding this, feel free to text or call, inshallah, and we will aid you with this. This is the best way, and we can set up a time for you to turn in the money. Please do not put it on the credit card, because we have no way of really getting it out to give, to go and feed those who are in need. We could do that locally, or we may send it to Yemen or Afghanistan, where we have trusted individuals who will buy the correct food and give it to the needy people. And lastly, zakat al-fitr or the fitrana. This is $7 to $10, although for the fitrana, because it's double the amount of the sa', we're saying $10 per person, per household. This should be given, of course, well before the Eid prayer. We're going to start collecting it 2 weeks before the end of Ramadan. We will give instructions on how to collect it. Again, we may find the time on Saturday or Sunday where we're sitting in the parking lot with a box and you can just come and drive through and bring it there. We usually buy some food to give to the local brothers and sisters who are in need, and we want to give them some rice and flour and the likes of the, and pasta and the likes of these things. And of course, the majority of the money in the last few years we have sent to Yemen, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, and have fed many people. And that's the beauty of our deen, mashallah. So we will give guidance to those things as the month goes on. Always feel free to call or text if you have any questions along those lines. Salat al-Eid, as of now, the Veritas school has been rented, but we have not gotten an approval. Most likely, from what we're hearing from state officials and city officials, it's not going to be allowed for us to have it. Salat al-Eid can be prayed in your home as a family with no khutbah, no sermon, the way we do it every year. And we will give guidance to that again towards the end of the month when we know for sure that that will be the situation. My brothers and sisters in Islam, Ramadan Mubarak. May this be a blessed Ramadan for all of us. May it be a time where we get back to our deen, where we go back to the Quran. We're going to be posting lectures. Listen to them as a family. Subhanallah, they're not for you to just hear something to be pushed down your throat. They're for you to get closer to Allah, to learn your deen. There are people who are dying from this on a daily basis. One of us could be them. We never know when we're going to meet our Creator. Our akfan, our kafan, our shrouds could be on the shelf, and the next time it's pulled, it's meant for our bodies. My brothers and sisters in Islam, worshipping Allah is why we were created. Allah said, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah said He did not create jinn or mankind. except to worship Him. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, let us use this Ramadan to worship Allah, to recharge our batteries, to save our drowning selves from drowning in the middle of the ocean of this dunya, to get closer to the pleasure of Allah. And we ask Allah to guide us on the straight path, accept from us our fasting, our prayers, our charity, and everything that we do of good deeds for Him. Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, wa ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.